My name is Christian Tribert, and today I'll be talking about open source investigation. And I called this presentation In Pursuit of Facts in the Post-Truth Era, because it would be very easy just to talk about misinformation, about disinformation, about fake news. But this has all this very negative connotation. And what I want to show you is that actually by using the traditional questions of journalism, who, what, where, when, but within the digital era, we can actually uncover a lot of facts. And the group in which we're doing this is called Bellingcat. Bellingcat is just a website. We are really non-traditional organization. We all started as volunteers. What is open source information? It's basically anything you can find with a laptop or computer connected to the internet. It's traditional media. But a lot of the information that's online is also accessible, obviously, via social media, because people like to share things. But just to give you an impression that there is a lot of information available from events, let's have a look at this photo of this Russian sailor. We found this photo on a VK profile, and we were interested in this guy because he was aboard of a Russian ship that was probably sailing to Syria and maybe carrying things of interest. So this is collecting information, right? For example, on VK, you start looking for maybe groups where people are a member of, maybe you start looking for friends, and so on. At the same time, this guy is being photographed. There's also somebody at the shores of, this is in Istanbul, the shores here in Istanbul, also looking at this guy. Because here is video footage of that same boat. You see somebody standing on the deck, right? If we zoom in, so while his photo was taken, he was also filmed at the exact same time, showing you can find information from the same event, same location. So let's have a look at this photo. This was being shared hundreds of times on social media, saying these are refugees arriving in France. But people were quick to say, this photo is actually not what it says, what they are showing. They said, look at this photo. Actually, it's a black and white photo from the Second World War. But now, here's the thing. Neither of those claims are true. So this is basically what all in my presentation will be about. Fact-checking claims. Somebody claims something with a photo or a quote. And how can you investigate that using open sources? What could we do to investigate this photo? Name of the ship, indeed. If we zoom in, we can see Flora. But the interesting thing is, on the other photo, they took away, they blurred it out. So indeed, we could Google the name of the boat, and we can immediately find the results. Okay, this is a boat, and these are actually Albanian refugees coming to Italy. So it has nothing to do with both of the claims. But what if you don't see that name of the boat? Because it was not on the other picture. They smartly took it away, so people cannot Google the name. Who knows reverse image search? Basically, this is a tool you can use, you can install in your Chrome browser or in Mozilla Firefox or in Opera. And what it does is basically it searches not for a word on Google, but for an image. You can upload any photo on your computer or any photo you find online and search it in the image database of Google. So going back to this photo, we just can right click on the photo once we have the tool installed, and then we get results of similar images, of what Google thinks it is, and you can see Google already fills in, this is probably the Flora ship. And what I recommend is doing with any kind of photo you come across online, even in photo databases, do this with anything, always, if you want to check it. Everyone please retweet this. This is my little brother, Frank. He went to the concert in Manchester, and we can't find him. Manchester was a Manchester bombing. Right click on the image, search with Google, and we can immediately see that this is just a random picture taken from the internet, so it would be very unlikely that this is actually her brother. Nevertheless, such tweets are being used by media to show, okay, we're looking for this kid and so on. So in a few seconds, people could have noticed it is actually not real. Now, it gets even more serious. This is a civil society group, activists in Syria, and they say these are photos of the aftermath of airstrike by Russian jets. Now, right-click on the image, search Google, you know the drill now, right? Mm-hmm. And we find that actually half a year earlier, in 2015, this picture we can see here. This is May 2016. And they say this is photos from Russian bombardment. But hey, this is actually a photo published in 2015, so how can it be? Now you can see that doesn't mean that the bombardment didn't take place, but using photos that are not from this incident, other people can start using it saying you're lying. So here we have the Russian embassy in the UK saying, hey guys, you're posting a photo that's old. And they're right, it was an old photo. Now, this is maybe a very interesting example. This is the Syrian envoy, the Syrian ambassador, basically, to the United Nations. And what he is showing here is an old lady stepping on the back of a military guy, right? And he was saying, "This is the Syrian Arab army helping civilians in Aleppo." Well, you know the drill now, right? This photo was actually from Fallujah in Iraq, showing the Iraqi army. The envoy to the UN is presenting photo of showing how good his army is, but actually showing a photo from a different country. And this is such an easy tool, right? That's why, keep in your mind, from now on, I really would recommend you, any photo you see, always do reverse image search. Now I want to show you some more large investigations, what you can do with basically verifying claims. And first I will introduce you to a method called geolocation. And then I will talk a little bit about the investigation we did in the downing of MH17, the Malaysian Boeing. And then I'll be talking about the coup in Turkey. This is an investigation I did, basically verifying a WhatsApp conversation. And I am showing this just to give you the impression that basically only verifying a bit of information you can find online can become news itself. And this won the European Press Prize this year. And this last one are airstrikes in Syria and Iraq. And we'll be talking about Russia and the United States. But first of all, okay, geolocation. Geolocation is basically determining the exact location of a photo of a videograph by using satellite imagery or other ground imagery. I think this is... Now, why would you geolocate? Most importantly, to determine where events took place. So this photo we're seeing, this video we're seeing, is this really in Ukraine in 2015? Or is this in Syria in 2012? Or is it somewhere else? So you try to verify a location. Now, how do you geolocate? Basically, it's all about finding matching elements on photos and videos, most often by referencing these photos with satellite. Now you can imagine this geolocation can be very useful if you already did a search, reverse image search with Google, you don't find any results. But you still want to figure out where this photo is coming from, where it was taken. Well, then you have to do it manually yourself. So let's start easy. What would be the visual clue here? You can go, for example, to Google Maps. You find the bridges. You try to find maybe Google Street View exactly. You can find the exact location. What would be the visual clue in this photo? We have a road sign. We have shop names and so on. You can, for example, make a combination of the street name and the shop name and see, hey, type it into Google, see what you find. What we often do is basically trying to find the ground photos and trying to match them to the satellite imagery. What can you see on the ground photo, what you can also see on the satellite image? How does something on the ground look like from the air? So now I'll show an example how geolocation can actually help with fact-checking a military. In 2015, December 2015, Russia started an air campaign against so-called Islamic State in Syria. And on the official YouTube channel of the Russian Ministry of Defense, they published this videos of those airstrikes. And the only thing we are interested in is fact-checking. Why? Because people on the ground in Syria were saying, well, Russia is not bombing IS that much, but actually bombing other groups. Now, and here was Sergei Lavrov saying, well, this is not true what they're saying, it's the Pentagon who says it. Just ask the Russian Ministry of Defense who were bombing. So we were like, okay, then we just use their own information to fact check them. So we basically uploaded all the YouTube videos from the Russian Ministry of Defense and asked people to help us to find the exact location shown in those airstrike videos. And we found some very interesting results. Here we have a still, like a screenshot of one of such an airstrike video. The Russian MOD said this is near a city called Tapka. We found the exact location in Google Earth, but this was nowhere close to Tapka. It was in a completely different province, 125 kilometers away from where they said they had the airstrike. But at the time, both locations were in hands of ISIS, of Islamic State. So I don't know what this was, a mistake about location, somebody, I don't know. It was interesting, but it got more interesting. Let's have a look at this airstrike. So we see how something gets blown up. And they said it's in the Raqqa province. This is the Raqqa province over here. But we found this airstrike video in a completely different province. Now, here what it got more interesting. Why? Because they said they were striking ISIS territory, but according to all information, this location on the right was nowhere close to where ISIS is active. But hey, remember what I said in the beginning? Never believe what someone is saying. But last example. Syrian Arab News Agency. US-led coalition targets a water pumping station in Aleppo. So this is a very big claim, right? This is an agency, news agency, claiming that the United States bombed civilian infrastructure. So UNICEF was also, UNICEF, the organization, was also angry. So the question was, of course, can we verify that the US bombed it? Russian Minister of Defense publishes another airstrike video. Let's have a look. Okay, so we see something being bombed. They say it's near Khafsa Kabir. Well, for once, the location was correct. So we can fly to Khafsa Kabir and we find indeed the exact same location as shown in the video. Oil, they said they were striking an oil refinery. Russian Ministry of Defense was saying they're striking oil refinery. Everyone who knows that a water pumping station looks like from the air would think, okay, well, this doesn't really look like an oil facility, but rather like a water station. So we could find photos from the ground indeed showing, well, this is very likely to be a water pumping station. So is this a water pumping station or is this an oil facility? I was thinking, this is a big facility, so there must be official documents about this facility. Now this is a little trick if you want to find official documents, and it's like a file type search on Google. Official documents are often in PDF, so this is a way to narrow down your search. So I just typed in Khafsa, which was the name of the facility, and water. And I found an official document showing how a pipeline from Aleppo city, Gorod Aleppo, and the pipeline constructed and to the exact same facility we identified, a water treatment plant. We were just able to show that basically the Russian Ministry of Defense published their own evidence that they bombed a water treatment facility. Don't ask me why, because till the day of today I think it's bizarre. Well, what we found is that, especially in the first month, a massive amount of the videos, the locations was false. What was also possible to see in the first month is that after they got critique, like, hey, these videos don't show ISIS territory, that they changed language from ISIS, light green is ISIS, and then became more general, saying militants or terrorists. Now, we can, of course, put all these geolocated airstrikes on a map. Let's use the information from the Russian Ministry of Defense. This is, some general, I think, and he presents a map of Syria. They also published this map on their VK page. So what we did is very simple. We go to Google Earth, and we basically pasted the map of the Russian Ministry of Defense on Google Earth. So now we have a map of Syria with all the territorial control according to the Russian Ministry of Defense. Now, if we place all those geolocated airstrike videos on this map, we can see, okay, some are in ISIS territory, black, but by far most of the airstrikes are in an area where even the Russian Ministry of Defense says there is no ISIS. So you can just see how you can use their own information to see, well, there's something wrong in the claims they're making, because they don't even believe themselves there's ISIS there. Now, okay, this of course has been used by human rights organizations, this information has been used by newspapers, because it just showed that, well, you can use their own information to see that they're actually wrong. Now, before I move on to another example, I want to very shortly show you an example of airstrikes of Western countries in Syria. Now, the thing is, you can see already immediately difference with the Russian videos, right? The videos the US, for example, publishes show a very clean and neat war. They only show like an airstrike, very precise, on an oil jack. You won't see massive buildings being blown up. We did the exact same project with fact-checking these videos. The thing is, everything was correct. Now, why am I telling this? Because it would be a mistake, I think, to think, okay, we're only focusing on fact-checking information that I get to me, but I won't focus on information or a conflict I don't get information about. It's easy to focus on information that's given to you. Oh, look at Russia, fake news. And say, okay, all these videos are correct. But they won't publish the videos where something may go wrong. And this can be problematic. Let's have a look at this video of Russia Today.
And after this strike, numerous media outlets accused Russia. Some of them blamed Moscow right in the headline. Others were more careful, deciding to remind readers about accusations of Syrian and Russian strikes from the past, right under the completely different subtitle, U.S. Air Raids. And the false claims were not even fixed even after CENTCOM's statement.
The claim was, Russia bombs mosque. It are three research questions. Can we figure out whether an airstrike took place? Secondly, can we, if something was bombed, can we figure out who's responsible? And can we figure out what building? Open source information, it usually appears like this. On social media, there are claims, okay, something has been bombed. And collecting that information, I came across a photo of an alleged weapon remnant, a part of a missile. So I already thought, okay, probably an airstrike took place, but this weapon is Latin script and not Cyrillic. And comparing it with photos of American weapons, it was possible to see that the topography was exactly the same. Now, this was the start of an investigation, and we, based on open source information, we were able to say, okay, from this claim, Russia is not correct, it's the US. But airstrike took place, correct. Now, we challenged the Pentagon of the US. They confirmed, they said, yes, it was us. Yes, we bombed it. But they said, it's not a mosque. Eventually, the US admitted that they were wrong. And I want to show you a short part of a video. What this video shows is that based on all the open source information, we're able to make a model of this mosque and challenge the Pentagon.
On March 16th, 2017, at around 6:55 p.m., a U.S. airstrike targeted Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab Mosque in Al-Jina, in the province of Aleppo, Syria, while almost 300 people were gathering for the Isha night prayers. The Syrian Civil Defense, also known as the White Helmets, claimed to have recovered the bodies of 38 civilians. Five of them were children. The U.S. Central Command claimed responsibility for the airstrike, stating, U.S. forces conducted an airstrike on an Al-Qaeda in Syria meeting on March 16th, killing several terrorists, wrongly locating it in Idlib.
They said it was in Idlib, like the Russians, they were wrong with the location, after geolocation.
Claiming it was a partially constructed community meeting hall, that dozens of core Al-Qaeda terrorists were killed, that they deliberately did not target the mosque at the left edge of the photo, and that initial assessments did not indicate civilian casualties.
Now we make a 3D model of all this open source information.
What was the use of the building? Were there civilian casualties? And how did the incident unfold in time and space? Using available and sourced imagery, videos, satellite photographs, and survivor testimonies, we began analyzing the building before and after the strike. We have identified two large craters in the north part of the building. Munitions experts confirmed they are consistent with two...
Basically, here, we're doing the same thing as with the ship. You're trying to get the different perspectives. Where was which photograph taken, the video, the satellite image, what do we see and where is it? Now, this will continue and continue, but this contributed to... eventually, like I said, the US admitting that they were wrong. We were able to say it was a mosque, and we published this. The Pentagon reacted, and they said, well, good, not like this, of course, but good for you, you did the investigation, but you just don't have the intel, the intelligence, that we have, and we know this was not a mosque. But still, they started their own internal investigation, and then they had to conclude that they indeed struck a mosque, and they weren't aware that it was a mosque. They said, we simply didn't know it. Now, I'm showing you this. This is just one example of thousands and thousands of airstrikes. This is a map of Syria, and the bigger the circle, the more airstrikes, civilian casualties only. Mosul, Raqqa, this is, you can see, the bigger the circle, not even airstrike, but civilian casualties, we believe, due to airstrikes. And can you see, just only using this laptop, you can challenge major actors in the world and actually show that they're wrong about some things. Now, let's move to a completely different example, Ukraine. Again, we're thinking about claims. We want to fact-check claims. Russia has always denied military involvement in eastern Ukraine. And it's not hard to find evidence that they were indeed denying this. I mean, they're denying it all the time, basically. Now, the thing is, on the American side, evidence that Russia was indeed militarily involved in Ukraine was also shaky, not very credible. Let's have a look at this video. This is a US senator presenting evidence that Russia is invading Ukraine.
We have the Russians in there with the separatists doing horrible things, things that are just as bad as the things that are taking place in ISIS, in Syria, in other places. And just to demonstrate this, I brought back, and it's not a very fun thing to look at, but you have to understand what's happening there. Show the tank, hold up the tank one first. These are, Madam President, these are T-72 tanks. Now, Putin keeps saying we don't have any Russians in there with the separatists. It's not us. We're not doing it. Look, here they are. These are pictures we brought back with us. Those are the tanks, that all lined up, all of that within within that area of Ukraine. And clearly, that's what they are. Now,
how would you fact check this? Reverse image search, right? Let's have a look at this picture. We can find it back in a database of, I think, AP or Reuters. And these are actually Russian tanks along a road in South Ossetia. Let's have a look at the other picture. Russian troops entering Ukraine, the senator claims. But these are actually Russian vehicles in the Ardon Valley in Russia, heading towards the Georgian border. So this is problematic if you're presenting photos that have nothing to do with Ukraine. So basically what we started doing is collecting all the photos and videos we could find from military equipment, and we saw how it was basically being transported from the Russian side of the border into Ukraine. But then, of course, a very big incident happened as well in Ukraine, the Malaysian Boeing. It was shot down above eastern Ukraine, or at least it crashed in eastern Ukraine. The question was, what happened? Maybe you remember, actually, when this happened, this is over 3 years ago, 17th of July 2014, and you may remember that at the time, there were a lot of claims what may have happened. It was shot down by a Ukrainian fighter jet. It was shot down by a Russian Buk. It was a bomb planted on the board. Online, people started investigating the incident, trying to figure out, okay, can we find out more what may have happened? And this turned out to be an important picture. It was uploaded by someone in Ukraine saying this is a Buk, a missile launcher in eastern Ukraine. We want, of course, to verify, first of all, location, right? Visual clues. What would be the visual clue here? Can you decipher it? It's not the high quality picture, of course. Stoy. And then? Stoydom. Saying it out loud, guessing, is what we're doing when we are not sure what's written there. Just guessing it in Google. Try this, try that. And they said this was in Torres, and we found actually indeed a shop, magazine Stoydom, in Torres. We also found a document showing the address of it, because there was once a court document, I think, because once there was like a fight. Of course, not interesting for us, but we have the address now. Now imagine you're working in a newsroom. Some of you has found this. We fly in Google Earth to location. And Google gives you this location. People were saying that this photo was taken on the day that MH17 was shot down. Now, keeping in mind that Torres is in hand of the separatists in Ukraine, and that there is a Buk visible there, of course, this is very interesting information. And there is a possibility to also determine the approximate time a photo was taken. And this is called a website called Sunkalk. And you recognize the place, right? We can see the gas station, we can see the building. So this is the location which we have identified now. And based on the direction of the shadows, we can decide an approximate time of the day. This yellow line is the sunrise, and the darker red line is sunset. But there was a lot of footage like this from this same Buk transport. So we were able to map how a Buk missile launcher traveled through separatist-held Ukraine. This is very interesting because one of the theories was that MH17 was shot down by a Buk missile launcher. So we were wanted, of course, to investigate more. But at the same time, governments were also publishing information. And this is a satellite image which Russian Ministry of Defense presented 4 days after MH17 was shot down. And what they were showing are two satellite images, this one and this one. And they were saying this is a Ukrainian military base. And 4 days before MH17 was shot down, we can see a Buk. They say on the day that MH17 was shot down, on the 17th, we can see the Buk is missing. Now, they didn't directly say that Ukraine was responsible for shooting down MH17, but they were strongly implying that Ukraine was responsible. And let's be honest, I mean, it is strange, right? If there's a Buk, and on the day that MH17 was shot down, the Buk is gone. So can we fact check this? Yes, we can, and it's actually pretty easy. We're just going to compare the satellite image they presented with open satellite images from Google Earth, from Yandex. And there was one very interesting thing. Let's have a look at the trees there. Now, on the Russian image on the 14th of July, there are trees. But on public satellite image, there are no trees on the 17th of July. Now, of course, in theory, and maybe in practice, would be possible that in 3 days' time they cut down all the trees at this military base. But what seems very unlikely is if you take all the images from July, this is 17th of July, this is the 2nd of July and the 21st, and we can see there were no trees there in July. So how the hell on earth can it be that the Russian Minister of Defense there on the 14th of July, there's suddenly trees? So basically, 4 days after the Malaysian Boeing was shot down, they're presenting evidence which is misdated, which is fake, you could say. Well, this generated more interest to figure out where this book we saw in Eastern Ukraine, where it was coming from. And we were looking for footage from Buk missile launches at the Russian side of the border. You have to imagine, if you are living and you see this massive convoy, a lot of people will just make a video, put it on Facebook or contact it. But there was one problem, as you can see, it's just not one, but there are many books. So how are we sure that we're tracing the same vehicle? So basically we built a database of all the books we could discover. And we were looking for unique characteristics of these specific units, so we made sure we're tracing the right vehicle. So in that way we were able to, not only in Ukraine, to trace this book, but we were also able to trace this book in the Russian side of the border. So these are all geolocations. Geolocation here on June 25. 24, 23, and the trace ends at a city called Kursk. Now we thought maybe this originates from Kursk. And you type in to Google, anti-aircraft brigade Kursk. And yes, that turns out to be there. And they are active on social media because they have a VK group, they have pages, they say where they're working. And somebody was so kind to post an attendance list. So these are all names, right? So you can look for those names on social media and find them. But, of course, this is a photo not of interest, but they're also posting photos on social media which are interesting. Sometimes we didn't even have to geolocate those photos because they were posting in front of the places where they were. So in this way, we were able to see how this book basically traveled from Kursk in Russia to the site where MH17 was shot down. And even how it traveled back towards Russia, towards the Russian border, missing one missile after MH17 was shot down. So you can see how open source research can actually just identify potential suspects in this case. Why I want to show this example is because it's just an excellent example how verifying information can become news itself. Now last year there was the coup attempt in Turkey, right? And on Turkish social media, after the coup failed, this video was posted. Yes, we see a WhatsApp conversation on an iPhone, somebody is scrolling through it. This was the claim, is this is a WhatsApp conversation between the coupists. Now this is not something easy to fact check, but I wanted to see, can I maybe confirm that this is indeed authentic? Because this is leaked information, right? This is not necessarily open, it's WhatsApp. So I basically just went writing down all the messages and started seeing, okay, there is a name always, number, there is a time, and there is content of a message. Let's have a look at how I went about verifying these messages. It starts relatively easy. Traffic trying to enter Istanbul should be turned back. They give updates to each other, basically. They update each other about what's going on in the city. They're taking strategic points. They're blocking bridges, they're blocking roads. So we have a time, right? And we have the content of a message. So we can basically start seeing, okay, they're talking about the bridges they want to block. And we can indeed see that at around this time, the first people on social media start posting about, hey, the bridges are being, there's military on the bridge. So this was what I'm trying to do with all these messages. We have a message, and can I find open source information that confirms what is being said? Now, this is easy, but it gets more difficult if you have no clue what they're talking about. Brigadier Yigit, 66 is on its way. 3 minutes later, Colonel Korkut, 212 has been passed. I had no idea what they were talking about. So let's have a look at the first message. I dropped it. I thought, okay, I don't know what it refers to. I start looking at other information, just seeing, can I get some clues? One way was just to collect photos of military vehicles. And people already online also started noticing, hey, the license plates. Look, 117 and then three other numbers. 117 and three other numbers. 117 and three other numbers. So I thought maybe there's a system in Turkish license plates. Don't ask me why, but there are people that have as a hobby to collect license plates. Worldlicenseplates.com. Turns out to be black letters on white is military vehicles. It also turns out to be that 117 is for the 66th Mechanized Infantry Brigade. And, well, you already guessed it, I think. Of course, they're on social media. So, based on the information that's being posted there, I can basically fact check whether indeed 117 is also visible on the images they post. And indeed, that was the case. But what about 212 has been passed? No military unit 212. Random guess. I type in on Google Earth Maps 212 Istanbul. There's a result. I change the satellite image. I can see 212 on the roof. And I have an exact location. I think, okay, maybe they're referring to this. It's a big shopping mall. But this is my guess. So how can I see if the guess is okay? So I was thinking this is a big shopping mall. If there's a military convoy passing by while they don't know a coup is happening, people have probably posted something about it. So you can look for geographical, you know, we can find the coordinates now on Google Maps. And we can use those coordinates to look on Twitter, Facebook, to see who posted from this location. So let's go to Twitter. This is the code I fill in, a geocode with the coordinates. You can see now I can just get all the tweets that came from that location. Same I can do with software that does it for you. This is EchoSec. I just go to the location and I get all the social media posts from that location. So in that way, I was able to indeed find military vehicles passing by. So each and every WhatsApp message was a little investigation like this. Identify military ranks, identify military units taking part in the coup. And basically, minute by minute, we could see how the people in the chat were communicating with each other about everything that happened. A part of the group says, okay, we should just kill people. Another part of the group says, no, I'm not going to do that. Some people are shot at point blank, as we can see here. And in the app, they just say, Asibadem, the neighborhood is done, about to hit the road. But it's just showing like you can, how you go about, okay, we have some claims or we have information, how can I try to verify it? And that's basically all what we do constantly. And I hope that I have given you a good impression of that.